Episode 205
of Futures Radio Show, sponsored by CME Group, the world's leading and most diverse futures and options exchange. CME Group's markets help individuals and businesses around the world effectively manage risk. For access to free educational tools and resources for the active individual trader, please visit activetrader.cmegroup.com.
Every day, traders and investors dive in to tackle the ever-changing markets to find opportunity. Futures Radio Show is your number one source for answers to the questions that all market participants want to ask. Veteran futures trader Anthony Crudele sits down with the most influential leaders and top traders in the industry. Now, here's your host, Anthony Crudele.
Hello, everyone. Before we get started today, I want to thank our sponsors. CME Group, Trading Technologies, RJO Futures, and Top Step Trader. Now today I spoke with Mark Gardner, co-founder and executive director at Prime IA, and senior trader, head of trader development at Cygnet Trading. We began today's chat with Mark telling us his backstory. Then Mark and I discussed the importance of traders not overcomplicating things and should be focusing more on the basic skills of trading. We had a great discussion on trading one contract versus multiple contracts. The fact that there is hundreds, if not thousands, of different indicators and strategies for traders to choose from when there's only two possible outcomes. Finally, we talked about having the mindset of human and machine, not human versus machine. As usual, thank you all for listening, and please enjoy this episode. Mark, welcome to the show.
Hi, how are you?
Doing really well, and it's great to have you on the show today. Now, we recently met, and we got to chatting a bit online about what I think is a very important topic, and it's trader development. And since you are the head of trader development at Cygnet, I wanted to have you on Futures Radio Show to get into a deeper discussion on this topic. I think it's very important for traders in the industry to hear what groups like yourself are doing to help traders develop. So we're going to talk a lot about that today. But first off, I'm curious about your backstory. I haven't heard it from you yet, so it'll all be new to me. Could you tell us, Mark, how you got your start in the trading industry?
I first stepped on the Sydney Futures Exchange trading floor. I was about 15 years old. I was doing the equivalent of the US internship work experience at high school. And yeah, the first time I stepped onto the floor, I saw the jackets and the screaming and was instantly hooked, which is a little bit of romanticizing it. But unfortunately, that was the reality of the situation. So I traveled 8 hours each way every holidays for the next 2 years. And I started on the floor at 17, about 5 days after my last my last exams, so which just so happened to be about 2 weeks before the Asian currency crisis, which was a whole baptism of fire, being in the 98 bank bill pit, which is sort of the Australian equivalent of the euro dollars. So it was interesting times.
Yeah. So were you an athlete in high school, or did you do anything that was competitive? Because to me, it sounds a lot like you went on the floor, saw the people, and the people drew you in, almost like the competitive spirit versus the market, or was it the pricing of the markets that drew you in?
I was a middle distance runner at school, 800 meters and 1500 meters. So yeah, I was, the most painful of the track events. So, and I sort of went on to doing half marathons and marathons, but yeah, it was definitely the competitive nature of it, and watching the lights, and obviously being the definite raw competitive nature of it all.
So you say that you're a runner. I too am a runner. I run a couple days at least every week. You know, not real long distances, but I run 2 to 3 miles. You know, at least a couple times a week, and I find that to be a great exercise for me. Not only physically, but mentally, it's helped me a lot with trading. Do you still run, and do you find that it helps you at all?
It definitely helped. I don't do a great deal of these days. I've got I've got 4 daughters and 2 businesses and trading to deal with, so I'm pretty starved for time. But and also not to mention the fact that I sort of prefer to do other sporting ventures because I really dislike the fact that I can't run like I used to, and it kind of aggravates me a touch. So, but yeah, I definitely found it very meditative in the past and a good way to clear my head.
Yeah, I too have found it to be very meditative for me. And, you know, when you and I were chatting not too long ago, we were talking about how some of the most basic things I believe are more important than ever right now, because I think that so many people out there, whether it's on social media or in their chat rooms, they really overcomplicate the trading business. I even put a tweet out the other day that got a lot of response from traders, and I said that trading is not complicated. People complicate trading. I think that too many people are searching for these complex strategies as opposed to just, you know, learning and understanding the basics. And there's a lot to be said about understanding mindset, managing risk, you know, the basic execution skills I think a trader needs to have that you need to understand before you even look at a strategy. So, but that being said, I think a lot of people thought through that comment that I put out that I meant that trading was easy. And that's really the furthest thing from the truth. You know, I just think that people overcomplicate it. So I know that you work on trader development. So you're working with a lot of traders. Tell us what some of the basics that you are teaching these traders.
Essentially, it's managing the headspace and managing where their situation is. I mean, someone with a fairly decent foundation of capital can make decisions that a new trader can't. No matter how people, you know, want to say just trade the trade, not trade the money. Like you have to be very mindful of the fact that of where you are in your development process, and realistically, I think the whole overcomplication thing is exactly right. You're not saying that it's easy, but that is the furthest thing from the truth. But I think there's a definite element of people overanalyzing to mask the flaws in their trading, or make excuses for their poor risk management or their poor execution, etc. One thing I quite often hear is like, if only I'd overlaid this, or if only we'd looked at that, but realistically, it's a two outcome game, and I find it very intriguing that there is 100 to 200 common technical analytics for something that literally is a flip of a coin, which is not necessarily a comfortable comparison to make to my 20-odd year career, but it's definitely something worth facing up to and analysing. Is sometimes complicated it's definitely not the best solution. A coin with good risk management can make money, and quite often people don't want to hear that.
No, they don't. And I've said many times in my Periscopes and on Twitter, even on this show, that it really doesn't matter what strategy you pick to use. I mean, you have to find a strategy that fits your personality, of course. I think that that's very important in choosing the right strategy for you. But all strategies work sometimes, and I believe the best executor of their strategy will supersede any strategy. That's why I go back to understanding the basics of execution, you know, mindset. And I want to pick your brain a little bit, and if you could, just give us some basic skills that you believe traders should be working on a regular basis.
In all honesty, it really does come down to your pre-trade plan and sticking to it. I think I'll never let anyone who I'm mentoring trade a one lot, because a binary decision-making process is a massive enemy. In terms of if you've only got one decision to make, it heightens anxiety, and it makes that that one decision of getting in and out on a one lot just so much more important, and which then obviously brings an emotional side into it straight away. So I always encourage anyone I'm coaching to be trading at least more than two, so they can get out of one and get back in and things like that, and so they can always keep their headspace in a glass half full mindset. Obviously, knowing when they're beat, essentially, and also when they had a bad day or their worst day or whatever, and one of the routines that I'm always stick to and have done for years is that when I get a proper hit, hissy fit or tantrum or whatever, like I make myself sit down and watch the market, trade small, really small volume, and write out a list of proactive things to do to avoid the situation again the next time, and essentially how I can better do my job. And it's never about I should have watched this or I should have noticed that, or I should have cut at this point. I should definitely have not let my risk run to this level, which is the initial analysis. What I sort of write out for myself to be able to obviously see the next day, I avoid using words like don't and negative words. So I get to sit back in the chair the next day and, a note to myself with at least some positive language that helps me dig out of that negative space.
Yeah. For me, you mentioned trading just one contract is what you think a problem for traders, and I completely agree. I've been saying this for many years. Even traders I've backed over the years, I've told them right out of the gates, you need to learn how to trade three, and that goes back to some of the basics that I learned. It didn't matter what strategy I was executing until I learned how to trade three contracts, know what a full-size position is, and what I would consider a small position would be one or a two, or no position. I needed to know the difference between the three.
A one-lot position is a binary decision-making process, whereas a two-lot you can cut half, run half. You can, yep. You've got options on a two-lot or a three-lot. Like, I'd rather take the risk with a junior trader trading two than one lot, because in the end that trading one lot with that binary decision making element really tends to very much heighten the emotional side, because you can only get it wrong once. With a two lot, you can get it wrong twice, or you can get it wrong once and then get the next one right. So it gives the trader a little bit more freedom to not feel so bound to every single decision. So
yeah. And something else I want to talk about is something that you mentioned and how you said there was hundreds of methodologies for just two possible outcomes. And it's pretty incredible when you think about it. I've thought about this many a times myself. I mean, there's hundreds, if not thousands, of different strategies and indicators out there for a trader to choose. That's why I always say it doesn't really matter what strategy you pick. We've already talked about this today. It's about the basics, execution, mindset, risk management. Those things are what's really important. But you being the head of trader development, talk to us about how you work with your traders, about helping them rein it in and not be overwhelmed by all the different methodologies and indicators out there.
It's not very similar to what you said before. Like, it's not talking down about analytics, but it's very much about the fact that I quite often see guys who I'm coaching, the solution to their problem when they're trading poorly is I'll add another layer to my another analytic or another trend line or moving average, etc. So instead of actually facing up to the fact that they're not managing their risk properly. So I guess it sort of comes back to the fact that it makes it very easy to disguise and make excuses about your trading, which more often than not can be solved by just simple common sense and simple risk management. Perhaps adding a new layer of analytics can help improve a strategy, but I think generally the time to be doing that would be when you're trading well rather than when you're trading poorly, because it very much is used as a mask for poor trade management and poor risk management.
I want to comment on something that you had just said, and I think this is a very important point. You said something along the lines of when traders are going to add something to their strategy, they should be doing that when they're winning. And I'm the perfect example of this. I studied every indicator under the sun before I finally chose my strategy. And I executed it for a long period of time, found my strengths and my weaknesses when executing the strategy, got really good at it. And then I sat back and said, okay, now how do I get even better? And what I did was I started to add confirmations through moving averages. And it really helped me know when to be more aggressive and when to be less aggressive. So if I would have tried to do this from the beginning, I don't believe I would have had the same outcome. And to this day, I mean, I've been using the same strategy for 15 years, moving averages for probably, I don't know, anywhere between 10 and 12 years in my strategy. And I still look at them all the time. But once again, they're not my primary strategy. They're a confirmation to my strategy.
Yeah, it's not a be all and end all.
Exactly.
So, yeah, I mean, I tend to use Bollinger's and you know, daily highs and lows, and I do weekly. I'm in a routine of doing weekly prep, and that tends to work for me. But traditionally, I've been a spread trader, so I'm constantly watching multiple things in relation to each other, so that can change very quickly. So, yeah, I've got a spreadsheet that sits on my desk. It's on its like 38th version since like 2001. The good thing about it is that basically there's three cells and within that spreadsheet that even through, you know, the tech bubble, 9/11, the GFC, tsunamis, you know, Iraq wars, etc. It tells me it just spits out in those three cells what I need to do to balance my position and to get to a point that I'm my predetermined plan fits in with. So, you know, and it's sort of something I've sort of worked towards fairly constantly. It's just, you know, I think with my, I've got a guy who works for me, Quant, who we developed a heat map for market direction, but it was designed because I essentially was continually fading markets, which was a massive weakness of mine. So we essentially designed this sheet to give a big red, like, or red or green sort of, you know, stop sign to, you know, don't do that. So, you know, developing things that, you know, not only your strengths, but also help you plug the gaps in your weaknesses as well.
I love that point you just made there, Mark, and I think that's very important for any traders out there right now that are building strategies. I always go back to my personal experiences, and I understood my strengths and weaknesses in my execution. So when I started to build a strategy, I was able to focus a lot of my strengths, but also understand my weaknesses and keep myself out of those bad situations that I wasn't executing well in. I think that's extremely important when you're building your strategy. Great stuff, Mark. Now, I want to talk about something that you mentioned to me, a mindset that you have, and that's human and machine, not human versus machine. I think this is very important for discretionary traders to have, because I know from my, once again, my personal experience, I don't try and go out and beat the machines. That's not my intention. I already know that they're faster than I am. I already know that they can calculate data quicker than I can. So I know that's a fight that I'm going to lose. So I focus on using my instincts, my execution skills, and I use technology and machines to help me. So as someone who works with traders, Mark, how are you helping your traders adapt that mindset, human and machine, not human versus machine?
Essentially, there's been that sort of point-and-click trader versus algo or systematic trader sort of battle of the, which at, you know, at this point in time, I think the algorithmic trading systems are you know, very definitely winning. But it was one thing when I owned a proprietary trading shop for nearly 10 years and watching the, you know, individual guys get ground out, but also their ability to to survive. And it came from Garry Kasparov, the Grandmaster chess champion who took on Deep Blue in IBM's Deep Blue, in sort of one of the first essentially battles of computer intelligence versus human intelligence back in the early 90s. And he does a great TED talk on the fact that in the end he was defeated by brute force computing power. However, what that led to was a chess competition that it can be computers and human chess players combined. And the two guys that won it were on normal PCs, and they weren't grandmaster chess players, and they basically had the best interface. And it's sort of a bit of the basis of the software company I've started, Prime IA, which is not a spelling mistake. It's intelligence amplification, not artificial intelligence. And essentially, it comes back to the fact that all the greatest advancements in technology have always been technology helping humans, not the direction that everyone seems to be talking about at the moment, where with the rise of the machines and computers will think for us, etc. So you can sort of see with better interfacing, like voice command, or we can, with our software, we're using like biometrics as well, like galvanic skin response and heart rate to basically measure your stress level, to overlay on your trading, to overlay on market conditions, to really give that human point-and-click trader all the same edges that an algorithmic system has, which is run by a team of people. So it really comes back to human beings' parallel thought processes and ability to think in many different threads is far more superior than just the brute force computing power of a mathematical system. So the money hasn't been pushed in that direction because humans are prickly characters to try and adapt to, I guess. So computers are pretty easy. Then ask for bonuses.
Yeah. Now, something that I've talked about myself a lot is that I feel that I'm a hybrid trader. I use a strategy that is automated for signals, but then I am a discretionary trader that then goes ahead and execute them because I believe that I can outperform the strategy than if it was automated, basically because I know when to trade bigger, smaller, or when not to trade it based on conditions. It doesn't always work out that way. I wish it did, but I'm more comfortable with that route. How are you working with your traders and helping them decide whether they should be completely discretionary? Are some of them using some automation? Or maybe just looking at a trader saying, hey, maybe you should be going fully automated. Is there any in between with you, or is it purely one way?
It depends. It depends on the individual, but I've got a fellow that works for me. He's a quant, and we quite often butt heads on certain things. And I learned quite a lot from his angle of his thoughts, and he's quite regularly surprised that I can see the patterns that I see. But it sounds to me like yourself and myself, like we're a very very solid abstract thought process. And which is essentially pattern recognition. And whenever I've dealt or work with pure quants, they don't like to understand that there's something that they don't understand. So and the best guys I've worked with, he hated Fibonacci. Apparently it was disproven years ago, and I said, but it doesn't matter whether it was disproven. If enough people watch it, then it matters. So, it really comes down to the fact that I think the best methodology would be a degree of combination of both. Some of the smartest people that I've met have become the worst traders. So they almost need like a trader to oversee them in a way. So I'm really sort of pushing my guys towards being more team orientated and trying to feel the best of both worlds as best they can, because I don't think we're increasingly becoming a world where one man can't take on the market anywhere near as efficiently as they used to be able to do. So
yeah, no, excellent insight today, but we're not done yet. I have some rapid fire questions if you're ready for those.
Yeah.
All right, everyone, our Rapid Fire segment is sponsored by Trading Technologies. You can access the global markets from virtually anywhere with TT. They are the world's fastest commercially available futures trading platform. And now you can trade cryptocurrency spot and derivative markets side by side. For more information, please visit tradingtechnologies.com. First question, Mark. What trader has influenced your life the most and why?
My old boss from the early 2000s, he very much taught me that to not lower your standards under any circumstances and always be hungry for the next trade.
What was one of the hardest things that you've had to overcome in trading?
Managing my headspace, definitely.
How has your trading evolved over the years?
I've definitely become much more technology-minded.
What's your favorite book about trading or the markets?
I don't like books.
What's the number one resource you spend your time on?
Things like your show and generally the internet.
What's your favorite movie or TV show about trading or the markets?
The Hunger Games.
What's the best piece of advice that you've received about trading or the markets?
Is just be better.
Now, if you can give a piece of advice to the new people interested in getting involved in trading, what would it be?
It would be the same. It just always find a way to be better.
Last question for today. If you weren't involved with trading in the markets, you'd be doing what?
Sorry, I don't understand the question.
I love it. That caught me off guard, man. That was awesome. All right. Where can people find you on Twitter and give us a website to check out?
On Twitter, it's at prime_IA or at 42 trading, the numbers. And online at primeia.com. And I think that's pretty much it.
Everybody, you absolutely have to go and follow Mark on Twitter and check out their website. Not only is Mark a great guy, he's got a lot to say about markets. Great insight today, Mark. Thank you again so much for coming on Futures Radio Show.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to Futures Radio Show. If you have any questions or comments for myself or my guests, please visit futuresradioshow.com and sign up to be a premium member for free. If you enjoyed the show, don't forget to leave us a review on iTunes.